All right, hello class, and welcome to chapter two. In today's lecture, we're going to be talking about what drives globalization. So this slide deck is coming directly from your textbook, and this video will be made available online for you as well. Let's get started. All right, so in 2005, six of the largest companies in the world were American. By 2010, only two of the largest companies in the world were American. So what is that telling us? It's telling us that the world is changing. And while globalization continues to happen, the world becomes more and more integrated. In a sense, the world becomes smaller and smaller. America led the charge. You know, America was that dominant economic force, that dominant capitalistic force. But that's changing. It's as if the other countries around the world are catching up quickly. It's kind of like a race got started and America had, you know, a 100-yard advantage, but now the other countries around the world are quickly catching up. Countries like Japan, okay, so some of the world's largest companies come from Japan. China right now is almost neck and neck with the United States. I believe, don't quote me on this statistic, but in maybe another 10 years or so, China's their GDP will be larger than that of America, which means they're producing more economic value to the world than America does. Okay, so it's really interesting. Now, with that said, here's something that's also interesting to note. America's population is only 350 million people. 350 million people. And our birth rate is slow. Okay, it's not exactly declining, but it's slow. Most developed countries have their birth rates, you know, are slower than countries that are less developed. China has 1.5 billion people. So China is roughly five times the size of the United States in terms of population. And their GDP in maybe 10 years or so is going to eclipse that of America. So that should tell you that the average American is spending a whole lot more money than the average Chinese person. Okay. Some of the world's largest organizations, the most influential in terms of employment, driving economic change, driving product innovation, they used to be all American companies, and now they're not. So you hear people talk about things in America. They say stuff like, oh, the good old days back when you could buy an American made, an American this, an American innovation. There's no doubt that America is truly a marvel of a country. Right. In many respects, we can look at that. We can also have a lot of complaints, but we can certainly acknowledge America's contribution to shaping the world the way that it is. But now that that shaping process is complete, a lot of other countries are catching up. OK, specifically, we'll talk about the BRIC countries, B-R-I-C, that is Brazil, Russia, India, and China. And these are the four countries that are expected to be the next dominant players in the world, okay? So you can think of this almost as if America was the popular guy, the popular kid, you know, and everybody wants to be like America. Everybody wants what the American company, the American person has, but now they're going to developing their own stuff, all right? And soon they're going to be equal to or on par with America. And we should be aware, as us who are living and studying and going to be working in America, we should be aware of what that means, okay? So it means that the likelihood of you working for a company that is not American increases dramatically. It means that the importance of doing international business and having fair and balanced trade terms is now very important. We can look at what happened in the last, under the Trump administration, when it came to trying to negotiate trade deals and everything with China. China no longer has to simply accept whatever American politicians say. They're large enough that they can stand up and state their own demands, state their own wants, and those demands and wants need to be heard, okay? So what's driving globalization? There's two main things, falling trade barriers. And the second is technological change. Falling trade barriers means that the barriers to prevent one country from doing business with another country are getting reduced. And this is the overall goal of most of the developed or semi-developed countries, is that they, you know, you have more trade, you have more economic growth and everything that takes place when you have little to no trade barriers. Now, what I mean by trade barriers are things like tariffs, taxes, difficulty making it, you know, government policies that make it difficult to exchange products one with another, okay? These are examples of trade barriers. So let's say, for example, China wanted to ship over a bunch of laptops that they made. The American government can place a tax on that. So if you're going to buy laptop, you're going to pay 20% more because the government now put a tariff on that. And what's important to note about that is it's the people, the citizens of that country that pay those taxes, okay? It is not the government that pays the taxes. The government actually is getting additional revenue. The idea behind tariffs is that once the once that product is 20% higher, then the other products that are in the store seem cheaper by comparison. So let's say there's an American laptop in the store that's selling without the extra taxes. That one may sell for $500, but here is the Chinese laptop, which would have sold at the same price, that's now selling for, you know, $520. So people are going to be more price conscious and they're going to probably gravitate towards the cheaper product. So it's an attempt to shift demand, okay? But ultimately, if you bought that Chinese laptop, that extra $20 is now coming out of your pocket. Or sorry, yeah, so the extra $100 or whatever 20% would be. So you guys can do the math on that. I'm talking and trying to do the math in my head at the same time, but I think it's $10. So the number of multinational companies have grown dramatically. Okay, and we spoke about this a little bit earlier. Your BRIC countries are your largest contributors to this. And companies are looking to gain a competitive edge by increasing their customer base and diversify their supply chain, which means that they're going to be looking to go overseas to get more customers. So they're already established in their own country. They're doing well, making lots of business, but they want to maintain growth. And this is the one thing about capitalism, is that it always seeks to grow. It always has to grow. That's one of the fundamental principles of capitalism, which, you know, can be looked at as either good or bad, you know, dangerous or, you know, very compelling, but it always has to grow. Your company, if it's staying the same, your revenues are staying the same, then that's considered negative, right? Certainly when you think about things like inflation, but the Wall Street, you know, the stock markets, your investors, they do not want to just stay status quo. They want to make money on their return. So there's this constant demand for growth, which means that companies are constantly looking to see, how can I get more customers? How can I sell more products? They're also looking at, how can I reduce my expenses? And by selling to people overseas, you know, that opens up a whole new consumer base. By diversifying their supply chain, meaning that they're willing to outsource some of the work to make their products so they can make the product for less cost. The net effect is that the company becomes more profitable, stock prices rise. So these are two things that drive competitive advantage. Okay, so emerging markets are becoming increasingly important. Presently, there's a shift of power from the West, meaning the United States, to the East, meaning, you know, Asia, or the Central Asia area, and also from the North to the South. And what we're talking about here is like the United States, and the power is shifting down to Latin America. They're the growing economy. They're where the markets are. That's where you have a lot of development still taking place and the opportunity to make substantial amounts of money from a large corporation perspective. And also from North to South, meaning the European area down to Africa. Now, I firmly believe, I don't have any research for this, but just kind of being a business person and putting the dots together, I believe that one of the largest untapped areas in terms of marketplaces and consumer wealth is that in Africa. The GDP for many countries is still fairly low. The average amount of money that people or the average person in Africa makes is still rather low. So there's a significant amount of room for improvement, whether it be, we're talking about infrastructure, you know, making roads, building buildings, improving housing conditions, telecommunications. This is virtually, You know, many of the areas in Africa have not been developed to this extent at all. And what you're going to see is that as American or BRIC countries, as their large organizations run out of customer bases, you're going to find that they're going to begin to look towards Africa as that primary customer base. So I would expect probably in the next 50 years or so that the hot investment place to be, the hot place to be, is going to be investing in Africa. Now, I believe that China's already figured this out, and that's why they're investing hundreds of millions of dollars right now in a number of African countries. Matter of fact, if you were to go to Africa, you know, and go to some of these countries in Africa, you'll find there's more Chinese investment in terms of building businesses, building buildings, doing infrastructure development than anybody else, okay? So I think China already recognizes that. And they're building those strategic relationships with the governments in these African countries that the United States, Russia, the EU are largely ignoring. So I'd expect that to pay dividends for them in the future. So the rise of emerging markets, right? So we forecast that China will replace the United States as the top economy in the world by 2050. Okay, so that's your official year. And India coming into a second, a close second. Now, what's also important to note with India is that their population is right around 1.4 billion, and it's increased by 300 billion over the last 3 to 4 years. So they're a young country in the sense of the average age of the person that's in the country, and they're having children. You know, so right now the United States, we are a fairly old country. Okay, the average age in America, we have a lot of people that are 60 and older. Okay, we call those the baby boomers, and they're leaving the marketplace in thousands. You know, every day. You know, they're retiring, but yet they did not have a large number of children to replace them in the workplace. So America right now, we're kind of like an ice cream cone, we're top heavy. And as that ice cream cone melts, you know, the smaller, the fewer children that the baby boomer generation had, you know, it's gonna be interesting to see how that develops. And this is a trend that you see in a lot of developed countries. So for example, England, many countries in the European Union, they're the same thing. As the country becomes more developed, the average income of people increases, so does the average education, and also so does the use of contraceptives, meaning that people can control how many children that they have. And they frequently develop the ideology that children are expensive, whereas in developing countries, children are not viewed as being quote unquote expensive, they're viewed as being a help to the family. So a significant difference here, but with that, one of the outcomes is that our population does not grow as fast. And with countries like, you know, China and India, you know, well past the billion person mark, I mean, it's going to be difficult for the United States to continue competing in that arena long term. Okay, so China is America's largest creditor, meaning that when the government issues bonds, the government wants to raise money so they can build a road or build a highway or fix a bridge or do some major project, they would issue government bonds. Well, China has been, for the longest time, one of the largest consumers of those bonds. So China would buy that bond, those bonds, meaning that the United States owes China a significant amount of debt. Should China at some point decide to cash all those bonds in and say, you know what, we'll show you, America, give us all the money for these economic bonds, that would be a substantial financial hit on the American economy, okay? And I'm not an economist, but I can tell you the impact of that would be very dramatic. Emerging markets are growing at approximately 3% faster than the United States. At this rate, countries will account for, emerging countries are going to account for 2/3 of the world's output by 2030. Okay, and here we have our BRIC countries, China, India, Indonesia. Well, Indonesia is included in there, but China, India, Russia, and Brazil. So I should have Russia in here as well. Now, this is a very important breakdown, you know, of how multinational companies or global companies think about the world, okay? So they group the world into three major components. Right here, you have the Americas, and that includes North America and South America. That makes a lot of sense, right? So there's a lot of countries in here, obviously, Brazil, Chile, Costa Rica, Mexico, United States, Canada. There's a lot of countries in here, but this section, and this swath of the world is called the Americas. The swath here in the middle, we call that EMEA. EMEA. And that should make a lot of sense when you think about it. We have Europe, the Middle East, and Africa. That's what EMEA stands for. Europe, the Middle East, and Africa. I write that down because that could definitely be a quiz question. Okay. And so that swath of the world is called EMEA. This other swath of the world is called Asia Pacific. Okay. And what's included in Asia? China, Australia, New Zealand, India, Mongolia, Taiwan, Singapore. These are countries that are all considered Asia Pacific. So oftentimes, if you're in a corporate world and you're working and it's a multinational organization, they're going to refer to sections of the world and they're going to call them by these names. Okay. So you want to make sure you're familiar with that terminology. Okay, so demographic changes. The world's population is growing faster than science actually predicted, with over 1.7 billion people in 2017. Let's quickly go online and do a search and see what the population is now, because even when I last looked at this 6 months ago, it's changed dramatically. So there's one population for the world is 7.67 billion. So 174 million people more than what it was, than what science actually predicted. And here, this is what's interesting. Okay, so here's a world clock. So this is arguably what I believe is the most accurate count of the world's population. So it's actually 7.8 billion. Okay. And they're counting every time someone is born. So I don't know how they do it with the technologies underneath that, but I think it's a reasonably reliable number when it comes to understanding population. So we're at 7.8 billion. And I want you to think about this. China represents 1.5 billion. India represents 1.4 billion, at least last time I looked. The United States, 350 million. I mean, just the number of people is dramatic. Let's quickly look up the population of China. Okay, so they're saying China is 1.4 billion people. Okay, 1.4 billion people. Let's look up India. I wonder if I could just stay on this page. But you can see the growth rate here is incredible, right? This is China's growth rate. And it's just been increasing just dramatically. Okay, let's see. I'll just do a search. So population of India, 1.387 million, so almost 1.4, and their population has been growing dramatically. And now let's look at the population of the United States. $332 million. So our population's actually declined. Okay, so I remember being around 350,000. It's actually down by about maybe 20 million or 18 million from what I thought it was. So really interesting, just given the sheer size of everything and yet the economic contribution of the United States. We spend a lot of money. Okay. The second trend, right, is there's a growing middle class. In a lot of these developing countries, the middle class is actually growing tremendously. In the United States, we're starting to see a greater divergence where the upper class is growing in more wealth, and then the lower 90% are decreasing in wealth. Okay, so, and fewer people are moving from being poor into the middle class. This is a very dangerous trend, and it often is the mark of many societies when they began to kind of go down, like every great society, like the Roman Empire, you know, the Ottoman Empire, they all declined at some point. And these types of indicators from historians have been a predictor of, you know, their decline. So we see that going on in the United States, but in a lot of these other developing countries, what you see is a healthy growing middle class. And that's important because people who are moving from being poor into the middle class, they have lots of aspirations. They want to have a certain type of house. They want to have cars. They want to have certain assets and material goods, which means that people in the middle class are spending far more money than they than people in the lower class or the upper class as a group, as a whole. This is the economic engine that drives a lot of the consumer demand within a country. So the real focus should be on increasing the number of people in the middle class, not increasing the wealth of the upper class, okay? If you want to have a healthy economy and you want to grow for the long term, what you want to do is make sure that as many people as possible can participate in the economic growth of the country. And you see that trend taking place in some of these developing countries that we expect to eclipse the United States or to begin to match the United States eventually. The third thing that's driving the change is aging populations in developing countries. So we talked about this, right? In developed countries, you know, they're getting older and that they do not have as many children. So the population in general becomes the average age of population increases dramatically. Whereas a lot of the countries that are growing and developing, they're younger, their average age of the citizens are younger. So for example, the average age of America, I don't know the exact statistic, but let's say it could be that the average age of everybody in America averaged together is 49 years old. Whereas if we go to China and we average the age of the population together, it could be 24 years old. The average person's age in China could be 24 versus the United States, which is 49. And that's that trend has, you know, dramatic implications, okay? The fourth trend is urbanization of the world's population. So I did mention this earlier, when I kind of talk about Africa being probably the prize continent in coming years. I mean, coming years, probably the next, I think, 20 to 30 years. I think a lot of the developed organizations and developed companies and countries are going to turn their attention to Africa, and they're going to find a group of people there who are waiting for their turn, waiting in line for their turn for economic development, infrastructure development, and so on and so forth. So it's going to be really interesting to see that happen. So over half, 54% of the world population live in urban areas. Now, what is interesting about humans is that we work better in groups. And if we go back in time and we look at how the human species evolved, you know, from a hunter-gatherer culture to, you know, now we're in cities, what we found is that when humans got together in group, they were able to split off responsibilities. They're able to now farm, which meant that they didn't have to chase food around or be migrants, you know, and following the herds as the herds moved along as the weather changed. But now they can plant crops and they can hunt and they can stay in one place and people can begin to develop specialized skills. Well, you're a farmer, you know, you're a skinner, you're a person who builds clothing, you're a hunter. And now people can begin to specialize in areas and their specialization would add value to the community. Okay, so people group together. And you see that same trend even today, because large cities, large urban populations, they hold the bulk of the population. Okay. This is very apparent if you look at the United States and voting. All right. So for the presidential election, you can see it's the large urban centers is where the bulk of the people are. And the rural areas, while people do live out there, it's just not as many people. For example, in China, Beijing has a population of over 30 million people in Beijing. By contrast, New York City, the largest city in America, has about 8 to 9 million people. Okay, so here's a list of cities, some of the largest cities in the world. I want you to bear in mind that you know, the largest city in America would be New York, and including the five boroughs. Okay, so Brooklyn, you know, all Long Island, including the five boroughs, we're looking at about 8 to 9 million. But here we got Shanghai in China, 24 million. Beijing, 18 million. So maybe I misquoted a little bit earlier, but Pakistan, 18 million. Istanbul, 14 million. So we can see that people in these developing countries, they're moving to the cities in search of jobs, in search of better living conditions, in search of sanitation. And this is good for some reason and bad for others. It's good because people are living longer, because there's better medical care in the cities. The medical care can be centralized in areas that help the most people. It's bad in that when you get a lot of people together, you tend to have greater levels of pollution, greater levels of carbon emissions, you know, that contribute to global warming. So urbanization generally is beneficial for economic development and urban population on an average. They're better off financially, lifestyle-wise, than their urban counterparts, than their rural counterparts, because there's better access, you know, you have better access to healthcare. The literacy rates are better because you can kind of centralize your schooling and education efforts for children, and life expectancy tends to be longer for people who are in urban areas. Bottom line is that humans are stronger when they work together. Urban populations do have drawbacks, as I mentioned before. When you get a lot of people together, you have all the social dynamics that take place. So people tend to mistreat others far more frequently, okay? So things like racism, discrimination, inequality, those things begin to manifest, you know, and show themselves far more when you have a lot of people together. Also increased pollution, as I mentioned earlier. But as far as like business, having these large economic centers, these large cities, means that there's one place that corporations can focus on delivering their products and services. One place they can focus on doing their marketing. Technological changes. So the internet has been largely, you know, arguably the most important driver in globalization and companies coming together. Because it's made information more readily available. It's empowered people with knowledge so they can, you know, be more knowledgeable about products. Perfect example is buying a car, right? When I was younger, the internet was just this very novice, you know, new thing, and many people didn't even have computers in their houses yet, you know. But, or if there was, it was just one desktop and it was reserved for special uses for homework or something. If you want to buy a car, you have to go out, trust what the salesperson is saying, or go visit a lot of car shops or dealerships or bring a mechanic along with you, right? But nowadays, you guys are just everyday consumers of cars. You have far more information at your fingertips than we ever had back then. You can simply go online to Kelley Blue Book and look up what the car should cost, understand what the conditions are. You can get a report on has the car been in any accidents or anything like that. So the internet has empowered just this wealth of knowledge sharing that takes place. Okay. And the great thing about this is people in third world or developing countries have access to all this knowledge and information as well. Okay. You get real-time information about trends and things that are going on. You're also able to share information and communicate with one another, you know, instantly. So mobile phone technology has driven significant changes, especially in developed countries. The thing about developed countries is that they didn't have all the infrastructure development that, say, us, the United States, or other developed countries have had. And what happens is that if I'm AT&T and I have invested literally hundreds of millions of dollars in poles and telephone wires, but I want to keep using that, that technology still works. So in a sense, they kind of fight or hold back progress, technological progress, because the move to 100% cell phones and means that all their investment from the legacy technologies is no longer of any value to them. And they don't want that. They want to keep their costs low. They want to manage their business. So countries that don't have all the technological development, the infrastructure that developed countries have, they can simply jump onto the new trends, the new technologies easier without all of the resistance. Technology is changing the nature of work, right? Production jobs are disappearing. And I know there's a lot of people that claim that globalization is the main reason why they lost their job. The job went overseas, it went down to Mexico. But it's important to note in America that most of the jobs, production type jobs that have been replaced, they've actually been replaced by machines. It hasn't been that they all were shipped out overseas. They just found ways to use machines to do that same work. And the one thing about machines are that once you have them, you don't have to pay them. And they'll work overtime and they won't complain. Okay, so there's a video I'd like for us to watch that talks about this company that, you know, I think it was GM or GE, one of the automobile companies laid off workers. And then a company from China came in and bought the warehouse and repurposed it to make windows for cars, you know, window shields, you know, the front window, side window, that kind of stuff for cars and automobiles. So they want to hire a lot of the people that were laid off and bring them into the factory, train them, and then use them as the workforce. They saw this as a way of developing strategic relationships with the United States. But it was a difficult transition. And the American people and the Chinese company, they had significant differences. Lots of conflict arose. The Americans were angry. They tried to start a union. The Chinese company did not want a union. They threatened to close the whole business down. It got really nasty and really bad. At the end of the day, Chinese people decided they were going to protect their investment. And ultimately, their decision was to move to robotic technology. So they would have maybe 20% of the workers that they originally planned to hire, and then replace everybody else with machines. And in doing so, they could maintain the production levels, avoid the complaints, and you see, a machine doesn't care what your cultural background is, right? So technologies, you know, here's a video, you can watch this. It doesn't make sense for me to play this now because we won't really be able to hear it, but definitely go to the slides and watch this video or type it in YouTube. And it talks about how machines are replacing people's jobs. That wraps it up for this particular lecture. If there's any questions, feel free to ask me, or you can email me, whatever you want. But thank you.